Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Shona Robison, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to provide members with an update on the work of the Scottish Government in carrying out to identify and remediate unsafe cladding, and specifically our single building assessment pilot that we introduced in 2021. This has not been an easy process for anyone. The Grenfell Tower tragedy shocked us all. It highlighted that many could be living in buildings that pose a clear risk to their safety, and that risk was never commonly understood by developers, lenders, building insurance firms and even surveyors and fire engineers. Overcoming this breakdown in shared knowledge and systems about what safety means has been central to our learning, and I want to share today how we plan to use that learning to help homeowners. I understand how stressful and frustrating a time this has been for homeowners, and I'm grateful to them for their involvement with us. I also want to reassure people that I expect the vast majority of buildings to be found safe. I know that for many homeowners, progress has not been quick enough, but we have to understand the extent of the problem in order to fix it. The purpose and approach of the single building assessment, which was a recommendation of our expert building and fire safety ministerial working group, is to carry out a comprehensive inspection of whole blocks of domestic residential buildings, looking at fire safety and suitability for mortgage lending. This is a free assessment with no cost to property owners. Single building assessments, or SBAs, identify what needs to be mitigated or remediated on a building-by-building basis and in line with the most current building standards. This includes the more stringent requirements laid last month that effectively ban all combustible cladding on relevant buildings. Our initial approach for the SBA pilot involved giving grants to homeowners typically through an intermediary, such as a property factor. And while this has worked, it came at a high cost in terms of time and demands, particularly on homeowners. It was slower than we would like and is complex. The spend on surveys last year as part of the pilot amounted to £241,000. Through assessing the pilot, we have concluded that this method requires to be changed as we scale up to a national programme. I wish to thank specifically the residents in the 26 buildings which are participating in the pilot surveys, and also the homeowners, associations, factors and others who have helped shape the process and understanding of how best to deliver at scale. I am clear that the pilot has been necessary, but as I have said, the timescales inherent in the initial method were proving too long and onerous for those not familiar with such a technical process. Therefore, I can inform Parliament that I have taken the decision to alter our method to allow us to scale up and expand the programme. Using powers and procurement tools available to the Scottish Government, we will now begin offering SBAs directly. This means that it is the Government which will take on the role of procuring surveys and fire engineers to carry out assessments on behalf of buildings. This takes away the burden on homeowners or the need for factors to move beyond their traditional role managing common parts. This will remove several months from the process of completing a lengthy and technical application and simplify the commissioning of survey work. Importantly, this will allow many more buildings to be brought into the programme at the same time, so allowing us to scale up the programme. As a result of this change, I can confirm every block in the pilot, which has not yet submitted a full application under the previous approach, has been written to with the offer of a directly procured SBA. I can also confirm that from today we will begin writing to more than 80 unique blocks that submitted an expression of interest last year to invite them onto the programme through a new simplified application process. To achieve this increase in pace, I encourage qualified fire engineers and surveyors to be ready to meet the demands of this programme of work. We have already begun the process of placing tenders for single building assessments onto Procurement Contracts Scotland and ask them to register and be prepared to bid. From 2023, we'll invite all remaining privately owned high-rise buildings, about another 100 buildings, into the survey programme, and we'll contact them shortly to explain the timescales and process. Our programme of surveys is important for today's homeowners and for tomorrow's too. As set out in our programme for government, by the end of this parliament, we will introduce a register of safe buildings. We're already working with the key institutions that will need to have access, such as insurers, mortgage lenders, the fire service and homeowners themselves. This measure will help overcome a key difference between our tenure system and that in the rest of the UK, the absence of a single building owner. Vitally, it will offer assurance to those who need it that a building is safe. I want to now turn to the UK Government's recent announcement on a developer fund. The Scottish Government has engaged in good faith with the UK Government right from the start on its approach to the Building Safety Programme. I've written a number of times with my Welsh counterpart, who I've worked closely with on this issue, to UK Government ministers, and only last week met with Lord Greenhall to raise my concerns about the way the UK Government has fallen short when it comes to basic commitments like collaboration and transparency, after saying from the outset that they wanted a four-nation approach. Instead, we've had little information and sudden announcements, with those announcements increasingly focusing on fixing problems in England only. It remains the case that the UK Government's approach to tackling key issues in England only benefits from powers only available at a UK level, such as corporation tax, which has been used to tax UK-wide residential property developers. However, we're continuing to explore whether any elements of the UK Developer Fund might still be applicable on a Four Nations level, for example, extending the scope of any legal agreement entered into between the Department for Levelling Up and the big Scottish developers of Scotland's buildings. The terrible tragedy of Grenfell Tower exposed the risk that many tall buildings were clad in materials that made the consequences of fire much worse and the cost of remediation huge. Presiding Officer, let me therefore move to the issue of funding. We received £97.1 million in consequentials in 2021-22, and this Government is committed to ensuring every penny of this and any additional funding received for this programme will be invested in assessing buildings and making unsafe buildings safe. However, further changes in UK Government policy mean we cannot be 100% sure what further funding might be received in future. The UK Government face the same issues as we do in assessment and remediation, yet the scale of cladding issues in England is not matched by the funding identified or committed from the UK Government. And this, of course, creates an issue for Scotland, because we only get the Barnett consequentials when the UK Government actually spend the money. So by shortchanging England itself, the UK Government is therefore also shortchanging the devolved governments. We've estimated that we may get associated funding of around £300 million as a share of already committed UK spending on cladding set out in the HM Treasury spending review published last year. And I will reiterate that our intention is to spend any associated funding we receive on assessment, safety and remediation so that we're adequately ensuring the safety of residents and supporting homeowners over the lifetime of this programme. However, given the complexity and scale of this issue, those resources may not be enough, which is why that will not stop us from doing what is right and necessary. We'll make our resources go further by working collaboratively with housing developers, the finance industry and homeowners to fix the issue properly and fully from the outset. So I now wish to turn to our engagement with the house building sector. It's become clear that even with the possible joint approach with the UK Government on the legal contract behind the pledges, this would practically only impact on around 12 developers operating in Scotland, a fraction of the total, most of whom are small and medium-sized. I'm therefore pleased to inform Parliament today that Homes for Scotland, the House Building Members' Body, has agreed to work with the Scottish Government to develop a Scottish Safer Buildings Accord with their members and the broader sector. Together, we will identify fair and workable solutions for all. I see no reason why a developer would not commit to doing in Scotland exactly the same as it is agreed to do in England as part of the UK Government's pledge. Developers must play their part in making unsafe buildings safe wherever they are. I've met a number of developers in the last few days, with more meetings to come, as we reach out widely to build our accord with those affected by unsafe cladding. And I'm pleased to say many of the major developers want to do what's right, and discussions have been cooperative and collaborative. We'll be working together on the fine detail of the accord in the coming weeks, and we'll be involving homeowners in this work. It's my clear expectation that developers linked to buildings with problematic cladding will fund remediation where this is identified. That will ensure that when public funds are needed to be spent, we can use them to focus on buildings and works where a developer cannot be identified or no parent developer exists. The creation of our accord with the house building sector and homeowners will form the basis of a way to address each building's needs. However, I want to make clear that if required, I will make full use of the powers available to us to bring parties to the table, including, if necessary, using legislation to do so. Presiding Officer, I hope this update has been helpful to members and to those affected by this issue. I look forward to continuing to update Parliament as we make further progress with this important programme of work. Thank you.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. I'd be grateful if members who wish to ask a question were to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement as well. The Scottish Government only began carrying out free single building assessments in August of 2021. Now, we know that by then many homeowners had already paid for safety assessments out of their own pockets. So can I ask a couple of questions with regards to homeowners who have been so desperately affected during this time? And what plans do ministers have to help cover those costs which have already been associated with this work the Cabinet Secretary has announced today? Secondly, homeowners which are now currently being prevented from moving or obtaining mortgages due to these flats covered in potentially combustible cladding are seeing their properties valued at zero. What discussions, therefore, have the government taken forward, both with the banks around these mortgages, but also with the insurance industry around affordable insurance for homeowners in these properties? Because I think all these three issues haven't been covered in the statement, but are really important for property owners.
Cabinet Secretary.
So, can I say to Miles Briggs, we will look and speak to homeowners about any payments that they've already made in terms of those assessments. And I know officials have been engaging with some homeowners around that, and we'll continue to do so because it's an important point. So let me be clear about the reason that the single building assessment is so important. And of course, it was only launched last summer because a lot of work had gone into to address the very issues that Miles Briggs describes, and that is that the single building assessment would have the confidence of the sector, of lenders, of financial institutions. So the reason that that's important is that we expect that the fact of a single building assessment having been done with the remediation work then identified should in itself be enough confidence for those mortgage lenders, which would enable people to be able to move their property on if that is what was required. So that shows the importance of getting that SBA right and getting it recognised to go forward. So a lot of these issues, of course, can be captured in the accord in terms of moving forward and making sure homeowners are fully briefed and informed. Now, Miles Briggs also mentioned the issue of insurance. And that, of course, is an issue that is reserved to the UK government. However, we have been discussing with the UK government around the need for insurance issues to be clarified. And I received a letter from Michael Gove just in the last few days, where he was saying that they were hoping to move forward with progress on the issue of insurance over the coming months, because I know that that is an issue of great concern to people. And I'm happy to perhaps arrange a cross-party briefing where some of these issues can be explained in a bit more detail, if that would be helpful.
Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for advance sight of the Cabinet Secretary's statement, but this pilot has compounded resident stress and worry about the safety of their buildings, some currently valued at worthless by financial institutions, because they've struggled to find qualified, competent assessors, and when I feel the government should have offered a true service from the start. All too often, government schemes like this are set up to push the work and the stress onto the householders in this pilot has shown that that won't work. Today, the Government have announced the delay that many more will now have to wait until up to 2023 for action. But can the Cabinet Secretary say whether she will agree to publish a timetable for the scaling and completing of this work, and agree to publish a quarterly report on the numbers assessed, the remediations completed and the spend of the £97 million plus any additional funding as it pays out contained within those quarterly reports?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I say to Mark Griffin, look, I recognise the frustrations that homeowners have, absolutely, and I do recognise the technical challenges and difficulties that not only homeowners but also the factors were struggling with in terms of commissioning reports, which is why I've announced in the statement the move to the proactive commissioning of the SBAs directly, and to try to harness the skill set that is in Scotland. And that's going to be tough because we need a lot of the skills to be focused on this work. So we're going to have to work to make sure that we are able to get those skills to take forward the SBAs at pace. In terms of the timetable, I'm happy to look at setting out as far as we can more detail on the timetable. I've set out in my statement the initial 80, then 100 buildings. That will get us way down the line of the buildings affected and prioritising those buildings most at risk. I'm happy to furnish Parliament with a quarterly update in terms of the numbers. I think over the next year we will see a ramping up of the numbers of SBAs being completed, and then of course the remediation work will scale up. I should also say though that a lot of the buildings after being assessed through the SBA process will be found to be safe, and that in itself will be important for those homeowners. I'm happy to work with Mark Griffin. Again, I can offer if he would find a more detailed briefing with some of the technical detail of some benefit and help, then I'm happy to arrange that on a cross-party basis.
CoCab Stewart to be followed by Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for this statement, and I would welcome a cross-party briefing on the further details. I am concerned, though, that despite assurances from the UK Government that the four nations would work closely together to tackle building safety issues, the interests of the devolved nations are being ignored. Does the Cabinet Secretary believe that the UK Government is no longer interested in coordination when it comes to cladding remediation? And if so, how should the Scottish Government proceed?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can tell CoCab Stewart that along with our Welsh colleagues, we have continually called for a joined-up Four Nations approach to this issue, because we thought that would be the simplest and most straightforward way of moving forward, given the complexity of the issues. However, a few weeks ago, the UK Government did move to what is clearly an England-only approach. That is despite matters, though, such as insurance, mortgage lending and corporation tax clearly being reserved and playing a major part in the solution. Due to that, and I think that for homeowners primarily, but also developers, that coordination between the nations would be a better way forward, and with Welsh counterparts will continue to pursue this. In fact, there's a Building Safety Four Nations meeting due to take place later this month, at which we will continue to pursue these matters along with our Welsh colleagues. However, and this was part of the reason for my statement and the announcement of the accord, I think we have to be realistic, and it does look like the UK Government is going in a particular direction of travel, and that's why we have to progress and plan our own way forward to ensure that we're doing the best by property owners when it comes to cladding remediation, and the accord will be the forum in which to take that forward.
Alexander Stewart to be followed by Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, individuals who have bought flats with flammable cladding have found themselves in an unfortunate situation with the value of the property plummeting and insurance costs rising. In the statement, you indicate that the Scottish Government is committed to ensuring that every penny of any additional funding received will be invested in assessing buildings and making them safe. Therefore, does the Cabinet Secretary recognise that more may be required to achieve the support for those individuals who have found themselves affected by this cladding crisis? And what steps will the Scottish Government take now to ensure this?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Alexander Stewart for his question? So, first of all, as I said earlier, on the issue of insurance, the UK Government have contracted with an insurance underwriter to back the provision of a UK-wide PII scheme. Now, there's been some delay to that, but it will provide professional indemnity insurance for fire risk assessors across the UK and will help to move things forward. But the issue of insurance for homeowners continues to be something we believe is best addressed at UK level because of the nature of UK-wide insurance institutions. So happy to keep Alexander Stewart and others appraised of the discussions around that. Yes, all of the money that we receive in consequentials will absolutely be spent, every penny. But we have to spend the money wisely, which is why in my statement I was clear that I expect developers, where they can be linked to a building, to remediate the cost of that building. But we want it to be done under the single building assessment, so it's done properly and it's done once, and to give assurance that it's done to a standard to meet all of the current standards. And that is important for homeowners and assurances. Will more money be required? Yes, it will. Now, obviously, we have the building safety levy, which the UK government just announced a couple of weeks ago, which is an England-only levy that's going to be levied through local government. What we will need to do is to look at what equivalent we may need to use here in order to bridge any gap, because the money that we will be spending, the public money, will be for those buildings where no developer can be found, and those homeowners must get the same treatment, and therefore we want to give assurance that that's where we'll focus that public money, and any gap we'll have to work through the accord to look at ways of bridging that.
Joe Fitzpatrick to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The expansion of the single building assessment pilot programme has resulted in properties in my constituency now being included, something which has been welcomed by affected constituents in Dundee City West. However, uncertain finances could undermine progress with the SBA. I wonder if, following on from the last question, the Cabinet Secretary could say more about discussions with the UK Government about the consequentials. I think it is really important that we make sure that the level of funding is sufficient to support the needs of the work that requires to be done across Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
So first of all, I was really pleased to be able to support the expansion of the pilot, and today I've announced that our new programme will tackle the most complex buildings, increase the properties in the programme, remove the burden from homeowners. And I know that that will be of particular importance to Joe Fitzpatrick, some of his constituents. So I think what I said in the statement about the funding is that the UK government has moved away from this essentially being Treasury funded driven to a mixture of funding, which essentially is partly through the corporation tax on developers and through the building safety levy. So that's quite a complicated landscape of funding. We have been able, after quite a lot of digging and backwards and forwards, to identify the additional £300 million through consequentials. What is hard to link, to find out whether or not how much of that is related to the corporation tax monies raised or whether that's through Treasury, it's very, very difficult to define. But I think one principle needs to be clear here, that any monies that are raised through corporation tax on a UK basis, that Scotland and Wales and Northern Ireland, for that matter, should get their fair share of that. So we then, of course, have to, as I said earlier in an answer, we have to look at where we would need to find our own mechanism to bridge any gap that we identify. The building safety levy is what is happening down south, what we need to find our equivalent, because none of that will generate any consequentials for Scotland, Wales or Northern Ireland, so we will have to meet the gap ourselves.
Pauline McNeill to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
I have written to the Minister on many occasions about my constituents in Glasgow who do welcome the fact that they have been prioritised for the single buildings assessment, but others will have to wait to 2023. But in both cases, it means that they can still not get adequate buildings insurance, which is actually quite dangerous. In view of that, I ask the Minister again, will the Scottish Government consider indemnifying those owners, standing behind them while we wait on the final outcome? Because if the Minister is confident that we will get to that point, then I think the Scottish Government shouldn't find that so risky.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, look, I'm happy to continue to discuss with Pauline McNeill around all of these issues. And the accord, I think, will give us a forum with not just with developers, but with homeowners as well, to look at what more we can do in the here and now. Clearly, the issue of insurance is very complicated. However, I would restate that the good thing about the single building assessment, because it has been worked through with so many critical institutions, that it will have the confidence of those institutions. So the point at which the SBA is completed could be a really important point in resolving some of these matters, rather than having to wait for the remediation works to be completed. So I think that in itself could perhaps give homeowners a bit of confidence that actually the SBA process itself will unlock doors for them. But happy to keep Polly McNeill informed about those discussions as we take them forward.
Thank you. Before we move on to the next member, I'll just perhaps make the Chamber aware that time is very tight and there are many members who would like to put a question to the Cabinet Secretary. I call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Developers should absolutely be expected to remediate cladding on buildings that they have built. But what support is available to homeowners where there is now no developer because they've stopped trading? How will the Scottish Government make sure that these buildings are also assessed, that any problems identified are fully fixed, and that there is no burden on homeowners in need of assistance?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I absolutely agree that developers must take responsibility and remediate the buildings that they have built and are associated with. And my approach is to ensure that we work in a positive way with developers on this in the interests of homeowners. And I expect through the Scottish Safer Buildings Accord to take that forward. As I said in my statement, this means that the public funds that we have available can be prioritised for the very buildings and works that Jackie Dunbar talks about that are without a linked developer, so that homeowners are assisted in every way possible. I think that is the best way to make maximum use of the collective pot of money as we go forward.
Willie Rennie to be followed by John Mason.
I mean, we are 5 years on from Grenfell, and I'm afraid it's really disappointing that the Minister comes here today to declare, after a year of this pilot being in place, that it's taken too long and too onerous. Homeowners have been aware of this. It's been blindingly obvious for a long time, as we've seen from the evidence that they have provided. So why is it taking so long for the government to admit that this pilot was failing? And the Minister talks about using powers to compel developers and other parties to come to the table. What powers, and how are they going to be deployed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, I don't believe the pilot hasn't been a success. I think the pilot has been a success in being able to test out the single building assessment. The problem has been the way the single building assessments have been commissioned. It has shown to be too complex and too onerous for homeowners and factors, and that's what we have learned and therefore are now switching to a commission basis. But the basis of the pilot and the single building assessment is absolutely sound, because what it will do is to help identify those buildings that are safe and can be given the green light, and that's good. But it will also identify those buildings that require remediation, what that remediation is, to do that on a once basis only, to a high standard, and to make sure that the developers that are associated with those buildings pay for that and get on and do that, and that we can support those buildings where no developer can be found. In terms of Willie Rennie's last point, I have every faith actually, that the accord, from the discussions I've had with developers, they want to do the right thing. Every one of them I've spoken to wants to do the right thing. What I said at the end of my statement was that should we be required that if there are some that don't want to come to the table, then we will look at using powers at our disposal to compel them, and we will look at legislation to do that if we need. But I don't think we'll need to do that, because I think developers want to be seen to do the right thing and fulfil their responsibilities. But as I say, I will keep Parliament updated on these matters as we go forward.
Thank you. I appreciate the Minister's desire to provide comprehensive responses, but we are very tight for time. And I call John Mason to be followed by Ariane Burgess.
Thank you. I mean, following on from the Cabinet Secretary's statement and her previous answer, it sounds like the developers are fairly positive towards what the Scottish Government's planning. Are the developers willing to work under separate schemes in England and Scotland, or are they just accepting that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, they are. It doesn't make it easy for anybody in this situation, but yes, they are. And I think that is important, that developers recognise that even though there's an England-only focus from the UK government, many of the developers are UK-wide organisations, and that their responsibility is to Scotland, to Wales and to Northern Ireland, as well as the work that they're going to do in England. So far, the discussions I've had have been very positive in that space.
Ariane Burgess to be followed by Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of the statement. Changes to building regulations secured by Green Minister Patrick Harvey mean that combustible cladding can no longer be used on high-rise building, but remediation of existing buildings must happen urgently. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary for her thoughts on a safe building assessment, an MOT for buildings, for every building in Scotland going forward in the future, so that we understand the components and the construction and make sure that things are fitted properly?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, Ariane Burgess is quite right that we have just passed more recent building standards around this issue, but they build on quite robust building regulations and standards prior to that. And I think that it's important to say that, and that goes back as far as 2005. So, you know, absolutely, the Safe Buildings Register that we've talked about and are committed to is going to be important for not just for homeowners, but also for those institutions that we've talked about in terms of mortgages and insurance. And that's a commitment, of course, as Ariane Burgess has noted, that we've committed to taking forward.
Marie McNair to be followed by Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The UK Government's move from the Building Safety Fund to a pledge letter in England clearly has impacts here in Scotland. Did the Scottish Government have advance sight of the April announcement, and can the Cabinet Secretary advise if the work on the accord she has outlined, which has been carried out since the UK Government's announcement, is going to cause any issues in the planned rollout of the cladding remediation programme?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, we really hadn't, neither had the Welsh, had any sight of the announcements that were made, which took us a bit by surprise, because until that point we had assumed that work was being taken forward, particularly around the levy on a four nations basis. But we are where we are, and we are determined to make sure that we now look towards what we can do here in Scotland. We will continue to work with Wales very closely, and we've got a very good working relationship there. And, of course, we have the Four Nations Building Safety Summit, if you like, that is taking place later this month, where we will continue to pursue areas where we might still be able to work together. But essentially, we will have to find some of the solutions ourselves.
And Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, flammable cladding has been found on both the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital in my region in Glasgow and the Sick Kids Hospital in Edinburgh. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell us if any flammable cladding has been used on any other government buildings? And if so, how soon can remedial works begin?
Cabinet Secretary.
So Annie Wells has raised a number of issues there, and of course we have said on a number of occasions that we'll support and work with public bodies and health boards to understand their current estates and make sure that they have done detailed assessments and to make sure that any issues are resolved. And where they're found, we'll support them with the technical expertise to assess and remediate as soon as possible. And I'm happy to write to Annie Wells with an update of the particular buildings that she cited.
Thank you. That concludes Ministerial Statement, Update on Cladding Remediation Programme. The next item of business is a Stage 1 debate on Motion 4310 in the name of John Swinney on Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill. I'd be very grateful if members who wish to speak in this debate were to press their request to speak buttons now. Thank you. Thank you.